Right. Good morning. Today is Thursday, May 26, 2022, for those in the future. And this is class 6 on the Weibu Sayadaw series, Teachings and Practice. And we're in the middle of the second chapter of the book, The Essential Practice, translated from the Burmese by Roger Bischoff. A collection of teachings, dialogues of Weibu Sayadaw and disciples or devotees. Actually, Buddhism wouldn't say devotees, we'd say students. And this chapter called A Roof That Does Not Leak. Basically, uses the analogy of a roof, the building of a roof, the function of a roof, to as a stand-in for the degree to which, or the self-protection and self-development associated with putting into practice Buddhist teachings. And so what I do is make final comments on this chapter and then go through Bodhipakya Dhamma at last, 37 factors of enlightenment, Bodhi, awakening, Pakya Dhamma, meaning factors of or qualities of awakening. So these are seven groupings of multiple factors as 37 total. While there's repetition, some factors are in several of the groupings. How to the building the roof that doesn't leak is knowing and applying these factors. Knowing and applying these factors, which are not just like things, they're actually guidance on cultivation of mind states, particularly associated with right effort, meaning the right effort to pick up or develop and acquire and develop good qualities, and avoid and release bad qualities. These are the four exertions or efforts that is one group within the 37, within the seven sets of factors. So seven sets of factors, each is multiple, altogether 37, with overlap or some repetition or certain factors that are in multiple groups. So in one of them, or one of the groupings, is called right effort or right exertion or factors associated with exertion. And interestingly, the exertion there, again, is simple about good and bad. Good and bad means what's helpful, what's harmful, what conduces to long-term welfare and benefit, what does not, what leads to greater freedom, what leads to greater binding, what leads to greater clarity, what leads to greater confusion or muddlement, what helps, what hurts, what's good for us, what's bad for us, like that. And that's really essential. Now, these are, there has to be a translation made between Buddhist guidance, which was, parenthetically, mainly for bhikkhus, monks, those seeking complete and perfect enlightenment, ASAP, to guidance for us here today, where we're not seeking complete and perfect enlightenment in one lifetime or as soon as possible, generally. And really none of us are. Because if you are, you wouldn't be listening to this. You'd be busy doing practice and with a teacher and in seclusion. Our issues are more psychological, or more emotional, mental, emotional, psychological issues, and that's aside from questions we may have about life purpose and meaning of life in the universe or karma and metaphysical issues. Our problems are mainly relational, emotional, self-oriented, associated with relationship, associated with our emotional process, associated with our sense of self. Relationship, third chakra, emotional, second chakra, third chakra, meaning emotional triggerings, second chakra, third chakra, thinking, feeling, visceral thought as emotion, and sense of self, second chakra. So second chakra, third chakra blockage, healing and balance is the resolution. That's mainly our focus, while the focus of those who, to whom these teachings were given, to whom these teachings were rightly directed initially, are monks, yogis, guys seeking attain, guys and gals seeking complete and perfect enlightenment ASAP. So some translations needed. Meanwhile, these teachings that were predominantly, particularly, I'd say, for monks and meditators, and lay people doing meditation too, can well be adapted or translated for us in our somewhat different focus, being relationship, conflict, and emotional triggering and distortions in sense of self. So, then, let me go through quickly essential practice to just highlight core teachings from Weibo Sayadaw to the disciple that condenses what he means by the roof that doesn't leak and integration, adoption, integration, application of Buddhist teaching, right? Integrate it. Adopt it, or adopt it, take it to yourself, integrate it for yourself in your own way, and practice or apply in your own way. At one point early on, he said, "You see, you think the teachings of the Buddha are vast and varied, but really, they're just one single way of escape from suffering. Only if you take up one object of meditation given by the Buddha and pursue it with steadfast effort to the end, can you justly claim that your roof is not leaking anymore. If your roof is not rainproof yet, you have to be aware of this." And so, just one method of making a sturdy roof is Buddha Dhamma. And there are other traditions that have a lot to do. They'll have a lot to say, or a lot of valuable teaching on how to protect us from harm, how to help us in the long run. But Buddhism is directly focused, front and center, on transformation of mind states, or purification of mind. Not as the final step, but as particularly the two stages of the three trainings, Sila, Samadhi, Prajna. Sila, virtue, ethics, morality, right action, right speech, right livelihood, and ultimately it's really right restraint, being careful not to do harm by mouth, by action particularly. Going to samadhi or pure mind training, concentration, and moving to equanimity, moving then to the third prajna or wisdom, which is really not just wisdom about life, but supramundane or insight, vipassana. Knowing the three marks, particularly three characteristics, knowing what, knowing deeply all phenomena, including thought, as impermanent, insubstantial, and stressful, and the emptiness of all that we take to be substantial and real, and increasing freedom from craving, and thus ignorance. So that's the ultimate goal. Or that's what wisdom, you know, the highest wisdom goes to in Buddhism. Buddhism focuses on that mind purification front and center. There's no other stuff about deity or guru or, 108 repetitions of this or that mantra even is not found in the early teaching. Just focus on mind qualities and purification of mind. As really the first and second trainings, Sila and Samadhi, applying Bodhipakya Dhamma, 37 factors, fully is in many ways a perfection in Sila and Samadhi. And then Prajna, wisdom, or insight, realizations, come naturally, actually, through meditation. So he explains further, we're building roofs because we don't want to become wet when it rains and we want to avoid the scorching sun. The teachings of the Buddha are available now. Take up one of the techniques that the Buddha taught. establish steadfast effort and practice. Again, he's very strongly focused on the importance of effort. Only if you're steadfast does your practice resemble a roof. And so practice becoming a roof, or one's life as a roof building. I mean, there are other ways of talking about a roof, but in terms of spiritual transformation. But here we're talking about protection against the sun and rain. Sun is fire. Rain is water. Fire is yang. Water is yin. Rain, yin, yin-yang. Against polarity. Against, ultimately, anger and grief. Anger and desire. Craving goes to clinging. Clinging goes to the three poisons or three unwholesome roots, particularly grasping and aversion. And so by root desire, we have countless, root clinging, we have countless desires. And by that, we have a whole lot of I want it, I hate it, I must have it, I can't stand it. And that gets into trouble in relationship. And that's associated with distortions of sense of self. And so all sorts of distortions in how we think about ourselves, lack of love and wisdom, actually, and problems we have in relationship that we co-create with the other, and emotional triggerings that just comes up and we get so upset, particularly rage and grief, sorrow, and fear, come out of not having a well-trained mind, not having a well-made roof, we can say. So we get wet, we get scorched, we are triggered to rage, we're triggered to inconsolable sorrow, we go to self-punishment or self-pity, we go to blame and difficulty to move to peace or forgiveness, because the mind, like the roof, is not well made. The roof is not well made, the mind is not well trained, like that. He said, so only if you're steadfast, meaning you've got to stay with it, does your practice resemble a roof, or does your mind resemble a well-made roof? Protective. It doesn't mean to, you know, it's not an offense against the birds. It's really a protection against elements of mind that harm us, by which we harm ourselves. Don't hurt yourself. The way to not hurt yourself, or not get into trouble, not make trouble, not get trouble, not be harmed, not harm self, is a well-trained mind, which is a well-made roof. And so he said, only if you're steadfast does your practice, or does your mind, I'd say, resemble a roof, and greed, aversion, and delusion, three poison, three unwholesome roots, cannot leak through. Only if the roof is not leaking can we say we're sheltered. If the roof is still leaking, is it because it's good or because it's not good? Well, it's not really about the material. It's about how well, see, it's not about the practice. It's about how well we've applied and integrated practice, how well we apply teachings. And so he said, in terms of meditation, and again, he's talking to people who are meditating, not attending to, you know, relationship problems, emotional triggering, and wounded self-image. But that's, you know, it's still applicable. He said, it's just the same in meditation. Now that you exert effort, there's no leak. You're safe. There's no leak and there's no scorching. If greed, aversion, and delusion, three unwholesome roots, still drip in, despite your practicing the teachings, you have to be aware of the fact that your roof is not yet rainproof. You have to know whether the roof you built for your own house is keeping the rain out or not, and the sun. So leaking, three poisons leaking through a poorly made roof. Of course, you know, we get stuck. We're triggered to aspects of three poisons, three unwholesome roots. You see, Buddhism in many ways, again, as it's formulated, in my view, for meditators, and we want some of the results of meditation without doing the work, well, that won't work, meaning we can't get the vast results that come from meditation without meditation. there'll be some limitation to how well we can do healing and balance without meditation. When Ra, I just talked about this yesterday in the self-healing or principles of self-healing series. Ra saying the prerequisite for work on mind, initiation of mind, training of mind, is ability to retain silence of self at a steady state, or I'd say silence of mind at a steady state, which means concentration, equanimity, peaceful mind, quiet mind. If we can't do that, which normally is developed mainly by meditation, then we can't, then we're hindered, we're hobbled, we're sort of unable to rightly do initiation of mind, training of mind, healing of mind, which is emotional, mind, emotion, mental, emotional. We can't really do that self, know yourself, accept yourself, if we are not unstable in mind. Know yourself, accept yourself, become the creator, right? Acceptance of self, forgiveness of self, direction of will. We can't direct the will to know ourself and accept ourself and move to forgiveness of self and other if the mind is unstable or monkey-minded with thoughts flying, you know, hither and yon, very unstable, very chaotic, thrown about by emotion. We can't even do self-knowing, self-understanding, and or self-knowing, self-accepting, and self-forgiving. We can't do that with a chaotic mind. Or a darkened mind, an unclear, you know, a kind of turbid mind, darkened awareness. So, silence of mind at a steady state, silence of self at a steady state, it really is silence of mind, not self, actually. Even if Ross said silence of self, there's no substantial self. So, how can there be silent self? It's silence of mind. Okay. So, you know, Ra's teachings have to be understood as a sixth density group, not eighth density or you know, free of the octave teaching from Gautama or Nityananda or presumably many other Buddhist and Hindu teachings teachers who finished evolution in the seven dimensions. So, it's silence of mind required for healing and balance. Healing and balance is know yourself, accept yourself, forgive yourself, or knowing mind, accepting mind, forgiving the sense of self or self for the pain we've caused self and other, the ignorance, the harm, whatever it may be. That knowing yourself, accepting yourself, forgiving yourself, knowing, accepting, forgiving, is done best with a quiet mind. Where we can see clearly what is happening or the causes or our dynamics, psychodynamics, that's called know yourself. And then we can clearly accept more fully what we're coming to know about ourselves or our psychodynamics with a quiet mind. And then move to forgiveness of what we've done or what we haven't done or how we've hurt others or hurt ourselves or made mistakes or whatever. All that is best done with a quiet mind or by concentration, by stable equanimity. You know, stable equanimity doesn't mean tree stump samadhi, as they say, meaning a dull mind, blank mind that can't think. If we need to think, it's important. And that's also a factor of enlightenment, is a skill in analysis. So the rain-proof, well-made roof is the well-trained mind, which is well-trained firstly, by the capacity to be quiet, to develop concentration, or by developing concentration can be quiet, silence of mind at a steady state. So even if Ross said silence of self, I will change it to silence of mind. Because it's mind that is stilled. The self is a whole other story. When the so-called self is stilled, actually the self, the identity is dropped. So it's not a. There is no self to be stilled, but there's a mind reactivity functioning field that needs to be quieted, to quietos. And so when that happens, then all sorts of knowing and accepting and forgiving can happen much, much easier, as well as avoiding what he's saying, the dripping rain and the scorching sun, of unhelpful desire and rage, of course, and fear as well. Going on, he said, the wise people of old practiced the teachings without allowing their efforts to diminish in any of the four postures, sitting, standing, lying down, and walking, and they kept up such perfect continuity of awareness that there was never any gap. You too have to practice in this way. The disciples of the Buddha established awareness of the spot, meaning between the nose and the upper lip, where the breath comes and goes, for Anapanasati, established awareness of the spot, and then did not allow their minds to shift to another object. Now, can the rains of greed, aversion, and delusion still affect those who are steadfast? No, they can't. And so greed, aversion, and ignorance, it seems to be a kind of moralistic, heroic way of talking about problems or dukkha of mind or tendencies that lead us to more suffering. And that's true. And for us, I think it's sort of desires that lead us to harm. We're not gunning for Nibbana ASAP. So if you're not gunning for Nibbana ASAP, then one ought to admit one still welcomes, cherishes, or maintains certain attachments and desires. Fine. There'll be some dukkha with that, but you can certainly refine the experience, you know, that attachment to desire, the dreaded admittance in the Buddhist Sangha, oh my God, we still cherish and maintain attachment to certain desires. Well, it's true. And so that's fine. You can be a liar if you like, but it's better not to be, because that also is harmful. Better to admit, I'm not a monk gunning for Nibbana. I'm a layperson or an ordinary folk seeking to make a good life for myself, which means I keep certain desires, and inevitably I'll feel certain dukkha or associated with that whole realm of desiring, while I also wish for healing and balance and equanimity and development of love, wisdom, and awareness. Okay, that's possible. But the one way of translating these teachings is we want to get rid of desires that are harmful. We want to know our desires clearly. We want to be real honest about where we're at, how we got into situations that are difficult, or how we got into situations that are great, where we find we're so happy. That's associated with the four exertions. And so the four exertions, or four efforts, which is what I'll get into, have huge bearing on purification of desire and anger. What we rightly should reject, what we are mistaken to reject, what we rightly ought to desire, what we really rightly ought to drop and no longer attach to or seek or engage with. Getting rid of, purifying the realm of desire and aversion and ignorance. Acknowledging that we still, inevitably wish to keep certain desires. We're not gunning for, cessation of subjectivity, cessation of avidya right now. We're not doing that. So we should be honest. And so the training of mind that supports the monk seeking Nibbana ASAP is the same training of mind that we can apply very well to our own level of development and our own degree of seeking, which is not a monastic yogi renunciate. So, a couple more quotes from Weibu Sayadaw in this chapter. Let's just see. one mention, one passage, which indicates again his perspective on Anapanasati. He said, "The men, devas and brahmans, meaning humans and higher dimensional beings, who receive the teachings after the Buddha's awakening, practice continuously, and therefore their respective aspirations for awakening were fulfilled. What the Buddha taught is enshrined in the Tipitaka, the three baskets. If you keep your attention focused on the spot and on the in-breath and the out-breath, the whole of the Tipitaka is there." And I think that's where I want to use as a launch point to get to Bodhipakya Dhamma. He's saying pretty clearly, the whole of the heart of Buddha Dhamma, meaning Buddha teaching, or the Dhamma, the law, the teachings of Gautama, is found in what is revealed by steady mindfulness at the spot, or Anapanasati. Steady Anapanasati practice, or the experience of such mindfulness, is revelatory. But if you're thinking about it, that's not the revealing, that's thinking about the process. So if you stay with it, full revelation occurs. And that's the tie-in to my sense of his view, which some have commented on, but it's, you know, it's hard to say without him saying directly, that sustained mindfulness or samadhi, sustained sati mindfulness, in samadhi, concentration practice, will naturally go to vipassana or prajna, panya. Panya, vipassana, insight, realization, release, comes naturally from sustained mindfulness, meditation, samadhi, fourth jhana, really. I think that's the case, personally. From whatever openings I've had, it didn't come from doing some special looking for this or that, but staying at the spot. And so he also said, the teachings of the, this is from the previous chapter, the teachings of the Buddha are enshrined in the Tipitaka, the three baskets of scriptures. Tipitaka is very extensive. If we take the essence out of the Tipitaka, we shall find the 37 factors of awakening. And so then let's go to them. So you can say that the essence of Buddha Dhamma is found at the spot, or is revealed by steady mindfulness, meditation, samadhi, and concentration at the nose tip, or, you know, where the nose, it's not the tip of the nose, right? It's the point above upper lip, or the nostrils, where the breath comes in, goes out. Staying there reveals all the heart of Buddha Dhamma, and I believe that's absolutely so. Another way of saying the heart of Gautama's Buddha Dhamma is the Tipitaka and then the 37 factors. So on the Wikipedia page on it, first saying, factors and wholesome qualities which are developed when the mind is trained, bhavana. And so refers to seven sets of such qualities regularly attributed to Buddha throughout the Pali Canon. Seven sets of Bodhi-related qualities, Bodhipakyadhamma, the Pakyadhamma that is of Bodhi, and recognized by Theravadan and Mahayanan Buddhists as complementary facets of the Buddhist path to Bodhi, Buddha, Bud is the Sanskrit root for awakening, I think. So, from Anguttara Nikaya 767, the Bhavananu Yutta Sutta. Bhavananu is bhavana. Bhavana, not bhavana yutta, but bhava. I'm not sure if the compound there is bhavana nu yutta or bhavananu yutta. It's bhavana discourse or bhavana development. Bhavana is cultivation and development anyway. Sutta on bhavana. Buddha is recorded as saying, here's a quote, from, I'm not sure who translated this. Just see. Nyanaponika and Bhikkhu Bodhi, 1999. Heavy hitters. Gautama from Anguttara Nikaya 767 said, "Monks, although a monk who does not apply himself to the meditative development of mind, bhavana, meditative development, or to bhavana, may wish, oh, that my mind might be free from the ashravas, asavas, by non-clinging, anupadana. Oh, that my mind might be free from taints by non-clinging, meaning free from asrava by no clinging, anupadana, not upadana. Oh, that my mind might be free from taints by non-clinging, yet his mind will not be freed. For what reason? Because he's not developed his mind, one has to say." That's probably not direct what he said, but not developed it in what? In the four foundations of mindfulness, the four right kinds of striving, the four bases of success, the five spiritual faculties, the five spiritual powers, the seven factors of enlightenment, and the Noble Eightfold Path. So, I wish I were free of, you know, this painful process, these painful dynamics in my mind. If there's freedom from clinging, eventually one doesn't, the roots of attachment are broken. Then we become untriggerable. Just like Ross said, for the fully balanced entity, no situation would have emotional charge. So no emotional charge, triggerable equals a fully balanced entity, equals lower triad, lower chakra blockage is substantially, nearly fully cleared, equals high development of green, blue, indigo, chakras 4, 5, 6, equals non-clinging. So it's all the same, or it all links, I think. So you can't be free of painful emotional triggering, nor trouble in relationship, nor distortions of the sense of self, without mind training. So we're doing mind training, whether we know it or not, to whatever degree we wish to do it. So how to develop the mind or bhavana? It's these 37 factors. And so we've got seven sets, total equals 37. Let me go through the seven categories first. All right. Four established, Chattaro Satipatthana. So we're talking about four establishments of mindfulness. Satipatthana is, sati is mindfulness. Patthana is like a station. Chattaro is four. And so four mindfulness stations or presences or establishments. Mindfulness of body, mindfulness of feelings, mindfulness of mental states, mindfulness of mental qualities, dhamma. So, okay, let me read these seven and then go into them. Four, chattaro satipatthana or satipatthana, patthana. Four establishments of mindfulness. Chattaro samapadana, four right exertions or strivings or efforts, and that's where I want to focus. Chattaro idipada, four bases of spiritual power. Pancha, five. So you see, first is the number and then the name of the grouping of factors. Chattaro is four, pancha is five. Chattaro satipatthana, stations of mindfulness or positions of mind attentiveness. Chattaro samapadana, four right exertions or efforts. Chattaro, four again, idipada, spiritual power, four bases. Pancha, five. Pancha indriya, related to Indra. Indra, the god, you know, actually. That's where the root comes from. Five spiritual faculties. Pancha, more five. Bala, strengths. Seven, it's not numbered. Seven factors of buddhi. Seven factors of awakening. So there's seven within the 37 that has the sort of overall title. Seven factors of buddhi. then Noble Eightfold Path. So, four establishings of mindfulness, four right exertions, four bases of spiritual power, five spiritual faculties, and five strengths, which are actually the same. Somebody's cheating, so they just basically wanted to puff up the numbers here, so they doubled. The same five qualities are in Pancha Indriya and Pancha Bala. So the five strengths are the five spiritual faculties, same. And they're the powers of Indra, the god, or the powers of a higher self, or a power of a serious seeker of light, fully committed. And we can develop some portion of these qualities ourselves. Seven factors of awakening, and then Noble Eightfold Path. So again, these are useful no matter what our relative intensity in degree of striving happens to be. Whether we're gunning for Nibbana ASAP or just, you know, serious practice and awakening, or periodic practice and just trying to help myself live a little better. Stress reduction, as they say. Something like that, or healing and balance. Which, again, is really, you know, significantly healing and balance in regards to our relationships, healing and balance as regards our emotional conditions and emotional triggerability, and healing and balance as regards our sense of self. And that's all led by know yourself, accept yourself, forgive yourself, or knowing, accepting, forgiving, which is green, blue, indigo, particularly green, blue, which is unconditional accepting, non-controlling, not grasping, neither grasping nor aversion, neither avoiding nor exaggerating our mental, emotional, particularly our emotional process. And to a large degree, when the sense of self is more healed, or we come to a more realistic, true, honest, you know, balanced sense of self, whatever the self may be, then we'll find ourselves less emotionally triggerable, and then better able to navigate relationship. And more clear in mind to realize which desires we ought to, you know, don't lead to good fruit, and which desires do lead to fruit that tastes yummy for now, which tendencies are helpful, which are harmful, which friendships are useful, which are not, which, you know, when it's right or reasonable to be angry and when it's not, when it's reasonable to be quite sad, or the reasonability of grief and sorrow versus dwelling and being attached to it and making a home in grief and sorrow and self-pity. So rightful experiencing of triggered emotion or catharsis versus getting attached to it and exaggerating and making a home in emotionalism. Also clearly seeing when we're avoiding that which we're, you know, we're suppressive person, an SP, as they say, when we suppress our own mental emotional process versus when we rightly put it to the side and say, you know, I just can't deal with that right now, or I know it's there, but I've got something else I've got to face right now, or yes, I've been crying for half an hour, no, I don't need to listen to the same sad song for another hour. It's okay if I do, but I think I'd rather not. I did enough here, and I don't think that's suppression. And it isn't suppression when there's been, you know, what is adequate catharsis? So when there's a difference between adequate catharsis and attachment to emotionalism, and I need to be feeling more. I can't stop emotionalism, or I can't stop feeling. That's called emotionalism in my book. That's called attachment to emotionality. And that's a problem too. Meanwhile, suppression of emotion is also a problem. So there's attachment, there's suppression, right? Grasping and aversion. Grasping is exaggeration and holding tight to hold, you know, holding as long as possible. And aversion, in some cases, is actually suppression and avoidance. It's not there. I'm not that way. Or, I don't know what you're talking about. Somebody says, you speak harshly, and you say, well, I'm not perfect. He'll say, well, I'm not perfect. Well, how about you? So, you know, don't be a dumb cluck. You know, this dumb cluck phrase, I'm watching a lot of 1940s movies. Preston Sturges, great guy, great guy. Preston Sturges, oh, another good guy. Listening to 1940s slang, very interesting. Very, very cute. So I just watched a movie called The Miracle of Morgan Creek. It's the follow-up to another movie called The Way of All Flesh or something. I'm sure for that. I've watched many. Morgan Creek. Very sweet movie, actually. Some portions uproarious. I mean, like, you know, my head-busting kind of thing. Uproarious. The Miracle of Morgan's Creek. Maybe 1940s. That's it, definitely. And one point he says, you dumb cluck. I like that phrase a lot, because it's sort of indicating the other is a chicken. And some people, you ever see chickens, when they walk around, they're like, goo-gee-goo-gee-goo, their head goes back and forth, up and down, you know, front, front, back, front. Some people, you know, have made themselves chickenish. So that's not a good thing. So when we're stupid or when we're acting stupid, we should admit, you know, I'm kind of stupid, or that was stupid of me. But then there's the difference between how we function and what we are. And so the difference between functioning and true nature. And discernment, wisdom is critical for that. So, of these 37 factors and 7 groupings, they're all important. They're all wonderful, actually. They really ought to be learned and applied. And I am not, you know, some exemplar of knowing these and applying them. So I'm just, you know, just another student on the way, just another point of light in the tapestry, sharing my understanding of these. 4 right exertions are critical, I'd say, as perhaps the most important, actually, of the 7 groupings of factors. Why? Because you won't even know you won't even be able to look at everything. We won't even know the importance of learning Bodhipakyadhamma without a development of the 4 right exertions. The 4 right exertions, 4 right efforts, chataro, sama, padana. We won't, sama is right, padana is exertion. And there's a little difference between this and right effort as one of the Eightfold Path, but it's really not, in my book, that different. There's a fine distinction, but it's not critical, I think. The 4 right efforts or exertions are critical because otherwise we don't really know where we should be focused and where we shouldn't, what is useful, what is not. The whole distinction of useful, useless is not even clear without this, or by this we develop some sense of what's skillful, what's unskillful. And so the 4 right exertions, let's say, the effort, 1, 2, 3, 4, effort for preventing unskillful states to arise, and then abandoning already arisen unskillful states. 3, effort for arising of skillful states, and sustaining and increasing arisen skillful states. And that's what Panya Sutta is all about, as I'll get into next week in the other class. 8 conditions that lead to the development of panya or discernment. Wisdom, 5th ray, discernment, clear mind, skill in analysis, all the functions of 5th ray are developed by those 8 conditions. And then, and that is sort of effort 3 and 4. What effort leads to the arising of a skillful state? So discernment, considered a skillful state, or wisdom, is skillful. It's skillful to have wisdom. Yeah. It's useful to have wisdom. It helps. And once we have some, or there is some functioning, because it's not really I have some, obviously. You know, I talk, we naturally talk, you know, presuming dualism, even though, you know, all is one and all concept is useless and Maya, okay, I got it. But the conventional way of speaking is he is wives, or he has wisdom, or he is growing his wisdom or discernment. I have some discernment and I am developing my discernment. Obviously, that's very poor language, because there's no substantial I, or the I that's intellectually formulated is Maya. It's avidya, you know, it's of avidya, really. Because dropping identity in sixth density means that identity is a fabricated, you know, conceptual experience that is insubstantial, essentially. And so anatta is anatta, or the mentally defined sense of self is insubstantial, in fact, in truth. So there's no I to have discernment. But, we can certainly say, you see, I just think that it's a little too depersonalizing to use these, to be very super tight with language. It's basically 8 conditions in Panyasutta for the arising of the skillful factor of discernment. And that's considered a skillful state. And continuing at those 8 conditions leads to sustaining and increasing this already arisen skillful state called discernment. So this just means that there's certain qualities we want to develop, or ought to be developed, and we ought to, you know, acquire them and develop them. Meanwhile, there's no substantial thing to be acquired or developed, okay, nor a substantial self as a box to put it into. Okay. So, in general, these skillful states are also all associated with green, blue, indigo. And the unskillful states are all associated with lower triad blockage. Okay. So, the effort for samapadanas then could be seen as a commitment to seeing when we are acting from lower triad blockage versus higher chakra activation. So then the first two, regarding what not to be adopted and grown, pertain to awareness of and making detachment from qualities of mind and behavior associated with lower triad blockage. So lower triad blockage is associated with unskillful states that we want not to arise, or we wish to release when already arisen. Which is basically, don't get stuck in rage, don't get stuck in grief, don't get stuck in fear. Or when you're in rage or anger or frustration or impatience, be careful what you say, or you will fall into wrong speech and hurt somebody and hurt yourself and acquire a little bit more bad karma, bad karmic seeding by being careless and allowing the already arisen unskillful state of rage or anger or frustration lead to unchecked wrong speech or harsh or malicious speech. Okay, so that's one way of looking at this. Likewise, there's grief and sorrow. I would not recommend preventing grief and sorrow from arising, not at all. And I wouldn't even recommend preventing rage and frustration and anger from arising either. But restrain your mouth, restrain your hands. That's not the same as suppression. So the first two here, the first two samapadanas, could be understood as pertaining to lower triad blockage. Unskillful states are particularly of lower triad blockage, but also higher chakra imbalances or lack of development, right? mental dogmatism, dogmatic opinionatedness, argumentativeness. I'm right, you're wrong. And forcing or pushing our ideas on others. Or excess of love over wisdom, or wisdom over love. Yeah. So argumentativeness, opinionatedness, dogmatism, argument, you know, enjoying the jousting of fighting, but getting real hot, is a wisdom over love. Telling somebody who's in pain, don't worry, it's okay, don't worry, it's okay, is a little bit of a spiritual bypassing because they're not okay. And if you just say, it's okay, everything be fine, maybe that's not true. Or let them have their pain. Are you trying to suppress their pain because you don't want to feel their pain, so you tell them it's okay, when it's really not okay for them? But you can be with them and hold them and hold their hand, or let them be in their pain and know that you're there with them. That's not the same as saying, it's okay, don't cry, don't cry. That sounds suppressive. So there are danger, you know, there are the unskillful states of love, wisdom, imbalance. Too much wisdom over love means a hard ass in talking and insensitive. Too much love over wisdom means you're kind of dumb and you kind of miss something. You don't see when you should be seeing. You're feeling with and not wanting to see. Or, it couldn't be. How could they? I can't believe. I don't want to believe that. This is a really love over wisdom, actually, imbalance, which is an unskillful state. Now, I wouldn't say prevent it from arising, but I would surely, because, I mean, that, you know, you don't want to suppress either triggered emotional release, lower triad blockage triggering emotional generation, meaning something happens as a catalyst, it triggers some emotional response, like anger, frustration, or grief, sorrow, or fear, panic. I wouldn't absolutely recommend trying to prevent that triggering emotional response. But the way of abandoning the already arisen unskillful state of the emotional charge is not suppression. You don't abandon by suppression and avoidance. You abandon by cutting out the roots. It's actually knowing and accepting. It's actually treat the already arisen, unskillful state, so-called, of anger, frustration, and grief, sorrow, and fear, panic, with love and wisdom, which means acceptance and understanding. Know it, understand it, forgive it. Now, sometimes that's not going to necessarily get rid of the sensory experience, the sensory component. The second skanda there of sensation, vedana, the vedana doesn't go away right away. You still have a pain in your heart. You still have a fear in your gut. You still have rage in your head. Whatever it may be, the sensory may remain. Even when we accept that it is, yes, indeed, I'm this way right now, and I understand the roots and the basis to some degree, if it's of anger, I understand if indeed you have or haven't wronged me. I may feel anger when you haven't wronged me. Then I'm really the problem. Or I may have anger because you did indeed wrong me. Then we're both to be blamed. Or we're both contributory. You're off and you're treating me unfairly, and I'm stuck in my triggered emotional response. Then, okay, we would know that. But I wouldn't recommend suppressing naturally arising emotional triggered response. We just need to understand it more fully. Same thing with sorrow. Naturally arising catalyst triggered emotional response of sorrow, grief. I listen to the song and I start weeping uncontrollably. It's probably, in my experience, not necessary to comprehend causation fully. I mean, I've had experience watching a movie, and it's clearly not about my life, or I don't see how the tie-in is. And then it triggers me into grief, sorrow, and sobbing kind of thing, and tears, crying, Right? I cry. Oh, yes, I do cry. Yes, yes, yes. Strong men cry, too. So, yeah, we got a lot of sorrow, you know. A lot. The longer you've been here, the more sorrow we have, by the way. So, and then it was very clear to me. I really don't know why this is coming up or what's the causation or the basis of it. I really don't know because the scenes I'm watching in the movie, I don't experience anything like that, or I don't even think of past lives where I've been like that. But it was fine. I could accept not knowing and continue to allow. Now, is that abandoning the already arisen unskillful state? Well, it's allowing the already arisen painful state. Is a painful state an unskillful state? Depends on your degree of dogmatism. Painful states like rage, anger, frustration, sorrow, grief, pity, fear, panic, terror, they're painful. They are, you can say unskillful, but emotion is not a skillful or skillful or unskillful phenomena of mind. Emotion is just the result of certain distortions in lower triad, or blockages in lower triad, and distortions in mind. It's essentially neither skillful nor unskillful, but it's certainly not helpful to long attach to emotional process. To become an emotional person, emotionalist, is not a good idea. But emotional process is natural and inevitable, obviously. So this is where some people don't like Buddhism. You know, this talk of skillful, unskillful states sounds quite judgmental, moralistic, and high and mighty. Could be. But you certainly don't want to make a home in painful emotional process. Likewise, there's the arising of skillful states and the sustaining and increasing of already arisen skillful states, which is basically the complement to the first two in terms of what's helpful ought to be developed, acquired and developed. And of course, we're not talking about a thing to be, pulled over and put into a box, and a flower to be watered. But, you know, you can say it like that if you want. These are mind states and mind functions and qualities of consciousness. And particularly what's skillful is that which is above the diaphragm. qualities of mind states associated with green, blue, indigo, fourth, fifth, sixth chakra. So all the qualities of green ray, all the qualities of blue ray, all the qualities of six ray are, quote, skillful states, are helpful. But then they need to be balanced, and they need to be rightly coordinated and applied. Somebody has their house burned down and you start lecturing them on metaphysics, that's called poor service, wrong timing, surprising blind spot. So that's wisdom over love and a lack of sensitivity. So we're talking about the proper balance of qualities of heart, qualities of wisdom, in service in any particular situation, appropriate. That's called upaya, skillful means. So the skillful or careful application of love, wisdom, qualities of universal love, acceptance, qualities of universal transpersonal discernment, wisdom, clarity, applied rightly, appropriately, in rightful balance at any one time to any person in situations. That's skill. That's upaya. And then there's six-ray also. When to use your cities and when not. And what to do with whatever cities you've got. And then just true understanding of the mantra of complete and whole and perfect, quality of awareness of law of one, qualities of mind of awareness of unity, complete and whole and perfect. Well, if somebody's in pain, I wouldn't be telling them things are complete and whole and perfect. I would be peacefully, calm abiding with them in their pain until the emotional subsides and discussion can resume. But I wouldn't jump to, it's perfect, don't cry. So this tetrad here, and this is an hour, four samapavadanas, you know, tataro samapadana, meaning the fourfold right exertions, are critical. And so we really, there's a tie-in, obviously, as I said, between lower triad blockage and what's here called unskillful states, and higher chakra activation and what's here called skillful states. But the right application of love, wisdom is critical. And the natural allowance without suppression of lower triad blockage, emotional triggering responses as naturally arising, non-suppression is also important. So there's unskillful states associated with doing harm. There's unskillful states that are needed for healing and balance. Right. So emotional charge as catharsis of the lower triad blockage, distortion leavings, stuff that comes up naturally, needs to be allowed to arise to be released. So preventing that is a problem. Meanwhile, getting attached to it or getting stuck in it or making a home or making exaggerating the narrative around it is also a problem. And so then there's the rightful letting go of the so-called unskillful states, in this case of emotional catharsis or emotional triggered pain, emotional charge. Abandoning it really has to be done with love, wisdom, with acceptance and understanding. And some faith and peace, some faith that it's impermanent. But you don't know how deep the well goes, so you can't presume that when it's passed in the moment, it won't come back again. Meanwhile, you ought to let the sobbing, let the crying go for as long as the body wants to cry. For as long as the eyes produce water and the body wants to sob, let it be as it is. But, you know, it's rightful to say, I can't stay here for another hour. So, then likewise on the other two, arising of skillful and sustaining and increasing of the skillful states. One needs wisdom to know what those skillful states are, which is really knowing well the nature of green, blue, indigo, seems to me. And then knowing what it means to be sustaining and increasing the skillful states or higher qualities of mind or qualities of mind associated with green, blue, indigo. And that's where study meditation practice comes in, study meditation service. Study and listening to those who know. If you listen to those who don't know, you'll get confused. If you listen to those who know but are damaged, you will have some problem too. So those who are damaged may know. Just make sure you know that they're damaged. Otherwise, you'll take on their damage. And also not recognize that some of what they say is not knowing truth. It's actually a distorted opinion coming from their psychological, emotional damage or lack of morality. So be careful. But study and listening to teaching is definitely a way, a means of increasing already arisen useful conditions or states like wisdom, discernment, comprehension. So these things all need to be considered. In any case, that's it for today. And I'll figure out next week where we go from here. So samapadana is critical. Right exertion. And the tie into the seven chakra theory is useful, actually. So, I hope it was helpful. It's good for me, too. Hope you're well. Take good care. See you next time. And good night.